Glad to be with y'all. So today we're jumping right, going to continue right along the path with John, right? So last week we talked about, hold on, let me move this real quick. We talked about the long discourse at the end of chapter 5, which as we talked about last week, there's lots of discourses in John. That's considered to be one of the most important, but it's also probably one of the least quoted discourses of all of them, which is a interesting thing. That is, theologically, there's a lot going on, but it's a tough nut to crack. So we ended up then going in and looking at the start of chapter 6, the feeding of the 5,000, which that's one of the few stories that John has, one of the few miracles that all four Gospels has, which obviously shows how important it is that it made it all into all four of them. And we'll talk about that more today. It ends with a little bit different twist, though. Jesus cuts everything off because they decide to force Jesus to become king. So he withdraws from the crowds because they're so excited that he can feed them and take care of them that they want him to be in charge, and does not want to be in charge. Which is a different, there's much more of a political bent, I guess, to the miracle, at least in the telling of John. So now we look at chapter 6. There's two parts. There's really three parts of chapter 6. The first, of course, is the telling of the story of the feeding the 5,000. Then you have the walking on water miracle, and then you have what's called the bread of life discourse, which is the whole rest of the chapter. But we'll just jump right into walking on water. Starting with the 16th verse there. When evening came, his disciples went down to the lake, got into a boat, and started across the lake to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The lake became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the lake and coming near the boat. They were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." And they wanted to take him into the boat. Immediately the boat reached the land towards which they were going. All right, so we'll do some quick geography for the Sea of Galilee, just so people have this all in their mind. This actually does matter a little bit. The western side is largely Israel, both historically and in modern times. That is the western bank there of the Sea of Galilee, or as it's called, the Sea of Tiberias today. Is largely Jewish and part of the nation of Israel, and that era was part of Palestine and was more Jewish, while the eastern bank is now known as the Golan Heights. It was under dispute. It's been under dispute since 1967 from the Six-Day War when Israel annexed it, or really, they got invaded, they responded, they took over that area, right, the Golan Heights, and have kept it as a protection zone because it is a higher area. The Golan Heights gives you an idea of that elevation difference. And so they have started building all sorts of items in that area, right? All that just biblical references, the ancient and the modern are the same. East Bank, Gentile, West Bank, largely Jewish, right? So it's called the Sea of Galilee or the Sea of Tiberias, and it's 8 miles wide at its widest point. So it is a big body of water. Maybe not as big as some in America, but it's certainly not small. And we do need to name that Capernaum's at the north. So I've got a map here just to sort of help you with that. That's the Sea of Galilee. Capernaum is that red dot on the shore. And again, you get an idea of when they go across the sea. As we talked about in the previous chapter, he goes to in the beginning of this chapter, when Jesus feeds the 5,000, he goes across the sea into that, most likely into that area there just south of Bethsaida, that is just wasteland, because that's the whole thing. They keep saying it's a barren area, it's a wasteland. And as you can see from this map, it's pretty much just desert on that eastern bank of the Sea of Galilee. So they go over there, have the feeding of the 5,000, and then they go back across the sea to Capernaum. And so that's the idea. So while the probably there at Magdala is more where it's 8 miles across, you can also see that Capernaum is considerably less distance. And depending on where you start, it could be a whole lot less, right? If you're a little bit farther north, it may be a really short boat trip. If it's a, if you start a little bit farther down, it might be a longer one, but it's hard to say exactly where, because we don't get a specific location other than it's a deserted area, an idea of where the feeding the 5,000 happened. All right, so some other items of note in the story. The disciples appear to leave Jesus and assume he can just catch up. There's not really too much of a concern, right? They just sort of get in the boat and take off. And they know he's not with them, but they just are like, oh, it'll be fine. Maybe, I guess they thought he was hitching a ride with the next boat. It's not altogether clear. Another thing I didn't even actually put in my notes, but reading it again reminded me, we have to pay attention, as always, in the Gospel of John. It is dark. It is evening, right? But it's also, Jesus is with them. So, of course, it's dark. The light of the world is not with them. So they are in the dark. Literally, it's probably nighttime. But also, the disciples don't know what's going to happen next. We can say it both ways for John. And they also just don't seem to be great fishermen. We actually have to name this because in the Gospel of John, they aren't fishermen, right? The call stories don't have any of those moments where we hear or see Peter or James or Andrew being with the nets or any of that kind of imagery. And so a little bit of a storm whips up and they start getting a little anxious and a little nervous. And you sort of go, really? I mean, if you've spent your whole life fishing on the sea, why would you get nervous about being in a boat in the middle of a storm? That's not the first or last time that would happen. And Jesus walks up and says, ego eimi, I am. It's probably okay to translate it as it is in the Gospel of John, it is me, but it's important to say that the literal translation there is I am. Again, this is Jesus. I think John wants us to know that Jesus is God. It's another I am statement, ultimately, in the most literal of senses. So, and I do think, in this miraculous moment where Jesus is literally walking on water, I think we're supposed to hear I am, like the great I am. Jesus is God and in charge of all sorts of things, and certainly the water and the storm as well. Finally, this is just a general note that I find Christians are always surprised about, but it's a most basic of notes, right? The Jews were desert people. By and large, whether they were living in Egypt or in Palestine, they were not known as seafarers. They tended to be inland. They tended to be land lubbards, I guess you'd say, for lack of a better sense. But especially, they weren't comfortable with large bodies of water. And so for Israel, whenever you hear about a large body of water, it represents chaos, disorder, the unknown, all those things that are fear-inducing. Because they talk about like that great Leviathan in the water, right? There are big beasts in the water. There's all kinds of unknowns in the water. You can't control it. They're not seafarers. They're not comfortable with all those things. And so water in general represents chaos. Whenever you read Old or New Testament, it almost always has that meaning. So when they part the Red Sea, it is God showing that he is an orderly God and has control over the chaos, right? Much the same way here for this, Jesus is one who can walk on the chaos, is not bothered by the chaos or the great unknown, because there is no unknown to God, right? God is in charge even of those most scary of moments. So that's just to give you the overview. I might have given you too much, I might have given you everything in the story. What else do we hear in the story of the walking on water in John's version? And I'll go back to it real quick so we can just see. Anything? It's really a very short telling, too. It's only four or five verses.
Well, I mean, it seems to be a lot of metaphoric significance here. Yes. So, you know, on the one hand, there's this notion of that Jesus has gone, but he comes back. I mean, so that's could be sort of foreshadowing what is to come. But particularly, you know, there's the point that as soon as he arrives, they reach their goal. that his presence with them is all it takes to be where they need to be.
Absolutely. I think your reading's probably the best, but sometimes I do wonder when I read this version if it, that is your idea that certainly when Jesus arrives is what matters. That is ultimately the goal, right? But there's almost a comedic level of this too, that they're so busy looking at Jesus in the water, they sort of while they're looking at him too, they're so distracted or something. There's almost a this goofy quality towards it, like, oh, you should get in the boat. Come, you shouldn't be out in the water. It's dangerous and all this kind of stuff. And they just sort of run into land all of a sudden. It's a pretty funny image into itself.
Yeah, I mean, to me, it's still about, you know, just like the passage about they wanted to make him king, and people still aren't getting it.
Oh, absolutely.
And I mean that if they know this is God and they're in God's hands and they trust God, then they don't need to be, you know, worried about hustling him into the boat. I mean, just live into the presence. And so, you know, again, it's as if the gospel writer and Jesus are at one level, and still there are these elements of humor because the people around him don't get it, don't understand what he brings, you know, how they should respond. You know, they're into the way of the world instead of, you know, the way of God.
Yeah, absolutely.
That they were expecting Jesus to catch up to him, and yet they get into the boat and row off. They're not expecting him to walk across the water to him, so they'd basically taken off without him.
Yeah. Yeah, there's the idea, I guess, that he was just going to hitch a ride on the next boat across.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Yes.
And they're about out in the middle at this point, right?
Yeah, they're well across the lake, right? It's really, what we're supposed to get from that is maybe it's halfway or maybe it's almost the whole distance. Either way, it's a long way, like 3 or 4 miles. It's a good way across the lake.
Yeah.
They had to be pretty tired at that point, rowing 3 or 4 miles.
I know, yeah. I would be.
That's a lot of rowing.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that they were terrified,
mm-hmm.
You know, when they saw Jesus, as opposed to being uplifted a little bit. But I guess they were terrified. Somebody walking on water, I guess I would be terrified too. But since it was him, I'd assume they recognized him.
Right.
It was just interesting that they used the word terrified.
Versus relieved or something.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Good story. Not to mention the fact that, you know, the funny thing is they all want to get him in the boat, right?
Right.
And he walked clear across the lake, but they're like, oh, get in the boat. We don't want you to sink. I mean, weird. Even in the midst of this miraculous moment, not having faith that it could even continue or something. I don't know.
Well, they did need some help rowing. So.
Yeah. They needed someone else to take a turn, right?
Yeah.
Right.
All right. So we will shift then. Go back through these slides. So we have the story of the walking on water, and then we sort of get across, right? So the next day, continuing with the next verse there, the next day the crowd that had stayed on the other side of the lake saw that there had only been one boat there. also saw that Jesus had not got into the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. All right, so we have this literal transition couple of verses that, again, is pretty comedic. The crowd obviously isn't getting it either. They had stayed in the boat. There had only been one boat, which makes you wonder how all that crowd had gotten across the lake, but fair enough. The first time, but now they only saw there was one boat. Jesus didn't get in the boat, but somehow he had disappeared. The disciples had disappeared. So they had to hitch a ride from some other boats that came from Tiberias, right? They find Jesus missing. They aren't sure how he left, but they know he isn't there. Again, you just have the same, like Lynn was saying, people aren't getting it, right? They aren't getting that Jesus is this all-powerful being. They just have this idea of like, hey, where'd that nice guy who fed us lunch go? I mean, like that kind of thing. And what comes next then, and this is where I find it fascinating, is the bread of life discourse, right? So the whole rest of the chapter is all about this bread of life. It is the bane of every preacher. That is for year C, so not this year, but next, but year C, there's, you don't know the lectionary, there's 3 years where we rotate through. In year C, it is a process where for 5 straight weeks, we break up this next portion in excruciating detail. We basically read the chapter 6 of John all at once, and it's all about bread and Eucharist for 5 straight weeks. It's not that we can't, any preacher can preach about it for a week, maybe two, but by the time you get to week 5, you're like, I don't have another bread story. Another wonderful story about communion. They decided to divide up those verses, these sort of endless bread readings, and really has that much to say about the bread. The other side that I find fascinating, and I think I put notes in this somewhere else, is what do we really do with, we have this miraculous story of Jesus walking on water, but because everything immediately turns, and we'll see in just a minute where Jesus starts talking about being the bread of life, and they start having this argument about bread, we lose the miracle almost completely. It's almost inconsequential that Jesus walked on water. It's just sort of like, yeah, that's what he does. We move on. Because you have feeding the 5,000, walking on water, and then this literally almost 51 verses of discussion about walking, I mean, about feeding and caring for people and all these kinds of ideas, you just sort of lose the walking on water. It just gets lost in the middle. But we'll talk about that more. We'll look at the next. We'll pause there. Anything about the crowds waking up or anything we want to tag about that group?
Well, I mean, Jesus, you know, they get this sign, you know, the walking on the water, mm-hmm. I mean, and the people, the crowd has reason to grasp that this is what went on. And yet they're still sort of stuck in their mundane worldview.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, what Peterson's paraphrase on this is, Jesus answered, "You come looking for me not because you saw God in my actions, but because I fed you, filled your stomachs, and for free." I mean, it's just this, you know, you don't get it. And so, I mean, it seems that that's then, that provides the introduction for him to go into this bread of life discourse, because he's just explained to them that this whole food thing is the way they typically think about it is not the way they need to be approaching him.
Yeah. No, I think that's absolutely it. We'll jump in and look at some of the next verses and you'll see more of it, but yeah, this gets into some of those ideas too. So when they found him on the other side of the lake, when this crowd of some size found him on the other side of the lake, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" You could probably also translate that, like, how did you come here? What happened? But Jesus answered them, truly, I tell you, you were looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Which gets a little bit into some of the idea, John, that Lynn was saying, really, right? Like, you could also probably just translate that, hey, you just like getting a free meal kind of model. And they then said to him, what must we do to perform the works of God? The first couple of times I read that, I had to say, where did that question come from, right, in 28?
Yeah.
But it is here. He says, you were looking for me now because you saw signs, you ate your fill. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures. So it's sort of there in 27, Jesus is saying, hey, work for the food of eternal life. And so I think that's where they end up asking that question, right? Oh, okay, well, if we need to work for something, what do we need to work for? Is sort of makes sense, but it's still a weird question. Jesus is saying, like, believe in the Son of Man and all these other sort of grand theological statements. Once again, humanity's on this very, or the listeners are on this really basic line, right? Of just going, okay, what work do I need to do then? What do we do to perform the works of God? And Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent. They said to him, what sign are you going to give us then so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. All right, so then Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, and again, we talked about it last week, but amen, amen is what it really is there, instead of very truly. But amen, amen, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. The bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And they said to him, sir, give us this bread always. So again, we'll pause for a moment. What happened to the walking on water? Like, the walking on water was almost a private miracle for the disciples, I guess. But it is completely, like I said, we get 4 verses for that and 71 for the feeding of the 5,000 and the bread discourse. Either John doesn't think it's important or it's just another insight into Jesus as God, but who knows? I mean, it's a weird, a lot of times this is called an inclusio where they have 2 stories that are put together to try and inform each other, except for I just don't know how this one is informing anything. I want to try to answer that, or you can disagree with me. That's a weird spot.
I'm not familiar with the concept of a private miracle. Is that something that happens throughout the Gospels?
Well, you have these sort of moments ultimately walking on water is in a way a sort of private miracle. It's really just Jesus and the men in the boat, right? It's not as 5,000. And even some of the healing stories, it's questionable how many, when Jesus restores the sight to the blind man, how many people saw him perform that miracle other than maybe just the blind man received his sight. It's not necessarily that it's private, like, oh, he doesn't want anyone else to see. It's just that not everybody's paying attention or engaged. It's not done in front. It's not done like in the temple precinct, right, where the whole temple can see what's happening. It's a little bit off screen or on the side. But not necessarily private, like everyone was trying to keep it secret.
Could he be showing to them, to a smaller audience, you know, what the crowds are asking, what must we do? And the answer is believe. Mm-hmm. So is that sort of like what he's talking to the others and telling them they need to believe it is I?
Yeah, I think that's possible. I think it's a way to understand it, certainly. Every time Jesus does any of these, he gets frustrated because he's like, this is the only reason you'll believe in me, but fine, I'll walk on the water, I'll feed 5,000, you know, I'll take care of some folks, but why can't you believe without all the miracles and the miraculous and almost magic nature of things? Why can't you just believe because of what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it reminds me of sort of a Benedictine message that, you know, the way to God is the way you live your life every day, you know, and, you know, working to be in a relationship with God. You know, they're asking for some miraculous sign. You know, I mean, what must we do to perform the works of God? Well, you know, and he's, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. I mean, you know, do, you know, follow me, just live it out. And they're looking for something perhaps more complex than that, more rule-based.
Right. Well, there are 613 laws of Moses, right?
It's interesting, Bill, back in verse 14, mm-hmm. where the people began to say, surely this is the prophet who is to come into the world.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I've formed this in by a question. Would it be well known by the people that when they use the term prophet in this case, that the person is automatically the person who has been sent by God?
I think they would, yes. I mean, I think they would all agree that it's the person sent by God. The hard part of, and it would be true today, right? Like, if you asked a group of Jews, who is the Messiah, or what will the Messiah look like, or who will the Messiah be? You get lots of different answers. You will have people who say, oh, he's the conquering hero, he's the military might, right? And then others will say, oh, the Messiah is like Elijah, he's a prophet, he's the great prophet, or the final prophet of the Most High, right? Others still would talk about the suffering servant, even from Isaiah, to a certain degree, like, they'll come among us to set the world to right and to give us God's shalom, God's peace. All of these were competing views at the same time. So it's hard to know exactly what anyone means when they say, oh, are you the Messiah? Is a pretty loaded question then and now. And the same, I think, would be true for prophet. Like, oh, we think this is the prophet who is to come. What exactly did that mean? Are they referring to sort of that idea of like the second coming of Elijah? That he's going to come and again be God's very powerful hand in the world? Maybe not. these are the things that, I mean, if we had a really honest conversation about what does it mean for Christians to look for Jesus to come again, that's a equally sort of confounding question, right? People would still say much of the same things that I think Jews would be arguing about, like, oh, he's going to set everything to right. Oh, he'll be a conquering hero. Oh, he'll be judge and there'll be judgment. And other people say, I don't think there'll be judgment, but I think there'll be reconciliation. Or all of these things start to overlap in ways that basically say we aren't sure how God's going to come or when, other than he's going to come. And so it gets confusing quick. I don't know if that helps you, Roy, but it is that they are definitely putting that out there. Without saying Messiah, they're referring more to prophet, but I think they have that idea in that phrase at the feeding of the 5,000. Like, he's just fed us. This is amazing. This is what the prophets of Israel do. That's what Moses did. This is what Elijah did at different points. He's clearly in that line of people who feed through God's hand.
Right. Okay. Thanks.
Yeah.
I guess what I was thinking is that he felt as though, even though they're saying he's the prophet, that somehow he gets a feeling they really don't understand. And so he has to go into this other discourse about it. Oh, and because I think verse 15, it said, Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to a mountain by himself. So he was getting the feeling that they just didn't quite understand. He was trying to make a strong point. Look, I'm not just coming to be a king or to be a king in a different way, I guess.
No, absolutely. It's absolutely the right reading. There is this idea that they don't get who Jesus is on that deeper level. And it's what Jesus is critiquing in these moments, right? Where Jesus is going like, you just got a free meal and you want me to be king so that you always get a free meal, not because you believe I'm going to fix things or I'm God's hand in the world and there's new justice. It's just a sort of knee-jerk reaction to a moment of being fed without really understanding the deeper idea beyond king, beyond prophet, beyond those sort of labels. Who is Jesus?
Right.
No, I think that's absolutely, you're reading that right. You got it, Roy. So going back to sort of getting into the Bread of Life discourse, they start talking about manna. If you don't know or recall that story, it's in Exodus, of course. They're wandering in the wilderness. They're hungry. They talk about how they want to go back to Egypt, and they miss the flesh pots of Egypt, the good food they ate there. And so God literally opens up the storerooms of heaven, and every morning there is manna. There is this sort of bread-like substance on the ground, and Israel eats, as the Psalms declare, the bread of angels, right? That this is the heavenly feast, and it is bread. For a sheer side note, and this is just those fabulous things that happen in language, we refer to it as manna. Jews will refer to it as manna. It's ultimately a play on words. Mana in Hebrew is what? So really when they're talking about manna, it's just saying like, it's the whatchamacallit, that stuff. They don't really know what it is. If you were to really translate manna, while it is what God and the angel, this idea that God provided for this, it's just sort of like, what's that stuff? The whatchamacallit stuff, the manna thing on the ground, the stuff we ate. And so there is this sort of almost tongue-in-cheek. We refer to it in a sacred way because it is sacred. It's a wonderful miracle that Israel ate for 40 years off of this substance. But it really is this thing where people just go, the manna, the things that they ate. But the deeper, and this is sort of what you were getting to, Roy, right? And what Lynn was saying as well. Jesus accuses them that all you're worried about is your physical hunger. What you need to be worried about is your spiritual hunger. Like, where is your heart and your soul in all of this? Not just, I got a nice meal. I got some bread and fish for free and ate my fill. Which is a critique in the first century and probably the 21st as well. We still work on that way a whole lot. If somebody feeds us or things get taken care of, then we sure like that person a whole lot more if we don't have to worry about it. Some additional ideas why we focus on these passages from John, but here's the bigger thing that I wanted to jump into. John does not have a meal at the Last Supper, so we have to do a quick contextualization for this. There is no bread and wine at the Last Supper. There's no words of institution. Jesus doesn't say, take, eat, this is my body. Instead, Jesus washes feet. The Gospel of John only has the foot washing. There's none of the other stuff that happens in the other three Gospels, or even, and this is where Paul even comes in and tells the story about at the Last Supper, Jesus saying, take, eat, this is my body. We don't have any of that in John. So instead, this whole portion is Jesus talking about being the bread of life and eating his flesh. And so we have understood this in terms of the Eucharist. We explore them as a Last Supper moment, even though it's not the Last Supper. Has done this fascinating thing where he has connected the bread of life conversation to the feeding of the 5,000 instead of to the Last Supper. Which always makes people's heads hurt because it's sort of crazy. But it's literally a moment where we understand them Eucharistically, and as we read them, they are literally lines that we use in our communion prayers, in our Eucharistic prayers. Jesus is the bread of life. Take, eat. Oh, there's a whole host of different lines that are in this narrative that you'll recognize as being lines that we will use in a Eucharistic context, even though it is very decidedly not the Last Supper. All right. We have the very first of the seven I am statements. In the Gospel of John, there are seven times Jesus says, I am blank, right? So this is, I am the bread of life. And Jesus makes this clear declaration about who he is, each of those sevens. But it's like ego and me, it's the same word as saying the great I am. But Jesus, on seven different occasions, it's, I am the good shepherd, I am the gate, I am the vine, you are the branches, right? You probably all, I am the resurrection, I am the way, I am the life, right? These are all the terms Jesus says about himself and who he is. This is the first of them, and they're all really important because they're the times when Jesus tries to talk about who he is and what it means to follow or to be part of his life and ministry. But they're very different because, again, this is not done in quite the same ways, well, not remotely the same ways as it's done in the synoptic gospels. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you get parables, you get stories, and other ways to hear about Jesus's story, or you even get the Sermon on the Mount, right? But in Gospel of John, you get these discourses and you get the I am statements instead. So it's a different way of hearing about who Jesus is. That's why this passage, that's why this whole chapter is so important and why we preach on it for 5 or 6 weeks. But again, it's where it can drive preachers crazy because you end up talking about bread and communion for 6 straight weeks. It's when it's good, it's always good to be in a parish like Holy Innocents where we have more than one clergy person, but it's especially good when you're walking through 6 straight weeks of bread stories. I can tell a story, then Buddy can tell a story, then Kenya can tell a story about bread, and we can share and not have to suddenly be caught up in all of that. These are all clear statements that Jesus is more than a prophet, right? That this is, Jesus is more than just the prophet or the king. The I am is the great I am. All right. I'm just going to go ahead and push ahead a little bit just so you can see. This is more of sort of transition to see how Jesus is going to talk for the next few verses. So what I'll probably do, because this is a really long section, we'll just pause after a couple of, I don't know, 2-3 slides of verses and see where we are and talk about those. But we'll engage as best we can, because, again, this is discourse. It gets confusing quickly, and yet it's also completely clear. So Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Are you looking at, is anybody looking at a Bible? I've lost 38, 39, 41 there. Hold on, let me look at it real quick. All right, so I'm pulling them up just on my phone real quick because I don't have the slide. So 39, so after this, for I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me, and this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. All right, I'm going to pause there, because that is a sort of turning point. We've sung, I'm sure you all know this song. We sing in our hymnal, right? I am the bread of life and he will raise you up. I can't sing that, sorry. But these are good, Bill. Messages that we pretty much just set to music. And I mean, I love it. It's a great hymn. It's a great anthem to sing, and it's all connected. And we will almost always sing it at communion because it is that I am the bread of life and I am feeding you and all these kinds of images. Even though, again, this is not completely connected to the Eucharist explicitly in the same way that it is in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. So you have this fascinating thing that we have very clearly said, this is absolutely, Jesus is talking about communion and the Eucharist, even though it's not said in that context. But again, this is a clear indication, like Lynn was saying earlier, that the ultimate ideal in the Gospel of John, what does it take to be a Christian? It's to believe in Jesus. It's to believe in Jesus and to do what Jesus is doing, to say what Jesus is saying, to abide with him, right? It's not even necessarily, there's not the list of things to do like there can be in the gospel, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, especially in those Sermon on the Mount moments, right? Where it says, oh, the blessed are the peacemakers, or blessed are the meek, or all these sort of ideas of who you're supposed to be or what you're supposed to do. There's no real idea of what we're supposed to do other than the whole point is to be with Jesus. Everything beyond that doesn't really matter. Right? Is the bread of life. He is with you. And the main point is to be with him, and he will raise you up, and you will have life, and you won't be hungry. You won't be thirsty. Also, these are also verses that get used a good deal at funerals. I will raise them up at the last day. Other thoughts about this opening part of the Bread of Life discourse?
Part of this reminds me of the last two verses in chapter 20. Sort of the, at the end of the original ending. Mm-hmm. I mean, here he says, this is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. The end of chapter 20 says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. I mean, it's that sort of echoes what we're being told here in chapter 6.
Absolutely.
It's all about laying out the, you know, a way of life.
It is. Absolutely. The other thing that's just sort of fun, it doesn't happen in the other Gospels, but it does happen in the Gospel of John, and that that is that moment that, again, I didn't put the verse in there, but from verse 39, and this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing that he has given me, right? Then Jesus actually quotes himself in the Last Supper narrative later on and says, it has been said that I will not lose one that anything that has been given to me. And he's literally quoting himself from chapter. Yeah. Right? Sort of quirky thing. You go like, hey, wait, didn't you say that? Did you just say that earlier? Like, remember when I told you that? So there is a sort of fascinating moment there where Jesus basically quotes himself in the own text, self-references, but it all works. I will not lose one that you have given to me. Oh, yeah, you did say that. But, all right, fair enough.
I mean, and the scene is kind of an interesting contrast with the encounter with the Samaritans. Mm-hmm. Because he's had the discussion about, you know, sir, give me some of that water. And, you know, this is, you know, sir, you know, give me some of this bread. And he says, you know, this is the real bread.
Right. Isn't that same?
All the Samaritans got it and were overjoyed. And these guys are struggling with it.
Absolutely. They're struggling hard with it.
but he's saying, look, you know, it's the will of the Father that all of you stay with me. I mean, sort of what's unsaid is, you know, if you depart or never come, there's, you know, that's the problem.
Yeah, it's interesting because it is pretty binary on one level for this idea of Jesus. Either you're with him or you're against him, right? But there's no real idea of like, well, what if I'm trying to get there, but I don't understand? Or what if I'm doing my best? There's not really an understanding for that. Well, I'll be honest, for where I feel like I am a lot of the times, right? A lot of days where I go, I think I got this, this, and this, but man, I'm not sure about these areas over here. But seem to be an option for John, at least the way it's written. It's sort of, well, you got to keep working and get in there quick. But it is fascinating. We'll keep looking. We'll look at the response of the Jews now, right? Lost one more verse there. Then the Jews began to complain about him. This is verse 41, because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." And they were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who has sent me. And I'll raise that person up on the last day. As it is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The Jews then disputed among themselves, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. And those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father." Excuse me. "So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came. That which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. You all got all of that, right? Every word. It makes perfect sense. So again, we have this sort of classic, and this is what Lynn was talking about too, right? The classic Johannine model of Jesus. He's speaking on a spiritual and metaphorical level, and people are hearing a literal story. That while Jesus is talking about terms of devouring his message and internalizing his teachings, people hear a sort of literal cannibalism, right? They're like, "How can I? I'm not eating that dude. No, this is gross." But Jesus is also pretty explicit, saying like, "It is literally my flesh and blood," and it. So he isn't helping the cause either. He's pushing it out there in a way that makes it difficult. And ironically enough, Catholics will literally, this is one of the major points that Catholics will point to as an indication for full transubstantiation, right? The literal body and blood of Christ. Now, this is that Eucharistic moment where Jesus is declaring that it has to be his body and blood. I think with all love to my Catholic brothers and sisters, they're missing that, they're sort of going in a literal sense in the same way the complaining people hearing it are complaining, right? They're going like, "I'm not supposed to eat body and blood. That's against, literally against the laws of Judaism, as well as just gross." And it's this idea, in the same way that I think our Baptist brothers and sisters are getting confused when they say, like, "You got to be born again. Give me the hour and the minute." It's much more, you have to be born spiritually again. You have to have a renewal of your life, not literally a rebirth, but a spiritual awakening. In this moment, I think Jesus is, again, speaking much more on the metaphorical level as far as, but clearly saying every ounce of what Jesus, who Jesus is and is becoming and will be, is all part of what we're supposed to internalize in our life, to take it in like we would take in a good meal and consume it and just make it all about everything we are as a result. So this is that moment we're always pausing to say, as Episcopalians, we actually don't believe in transubstantiation. We believe in we've been criticized as receptionists. That is, it's the heart of the believer, that Christ is worried about where our heart is when we receive the bread and wine more than what's happening with. So the quote from Richard Hooker is really like, it doesn't matter, but the heart of the believer. So that really what we're supposed to be working on is what I think actually is the point, and the reason I bring it up is I think this is the point of what Jesus is saying. Jesus is looking for a conversion of a heart, body, mind, and soul of the person more than he's worried about literal cannibalism or transubstantiation or any of these other ideas. It's much more, how do we completely absorb and become the teachings that Jesus is sharing with us, right? How do we follow the way in such a way that people cannot distinguish us from Christ in some way, shape, or form? That's the really quick view of all of that. There's a lot going on. What do we, how do we engage that with, like, oh, what, we have 5 minutes left? Real quick unpacking of the last, 2,000 years of theology with the Eucharist.
So when they hear it, when the Jews hear it, they are taking it literally initially.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, they're literally going like, how can we eat his flesh? Like, one thing, you're still alive. I'm not gnawing on your arm right now.
Okay.
There's a very clear understanding that the Jews or whoever is gathered, whatever group, it's listed as the Jews, but I imagine there's all kinds of different people, are all sort of going like, what is he talking about? How do I literally devour this man in front of me? They're definitely,
yeah, it's as if Jesus is really trying to be sort of in your face here, and mm-hmm. you know, again, you know, he's to an extent, he's kind of fed up with you know, with this. I keep telling these people and they don't get it, and so he says something that at one level would just be abhorrent to the Jews to think about eating flesh and drinking blood, and mm-hmm. so it's as if, you know, if that's the level you're going to operate at in taking in my message, you know, this is hopeless. And in fact, we do get this comment later on that just before we stopped, when many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But it, you know, it's sort of like a shock treatment. It's okay. Mm-hmm. This is what it's about. And they see, what does it take to get through to you?
Yeah. No, it's absolutely. And again, those next verses. That this teaching is difficult too. Can accept it. And Jesus basically goes like, "Oh, does it offend you? Well, too bad. What I've spoken is spirit and life. You got to accept it." And even then, he sort of goes like, "But among you are some who don't believe." And he's sort of referencing Judas, but he also seems to be just referencing everyone. But then the real key is in verse 66. Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. It's almost like Jesus, again, like you said, is being intentionally provocative and intentionally trying to push away these folks who just don't seem to have an ability deeper, don't want to go deeper, aren't interested in going deeper. So Jesus starts just pushing and saying like, "Well, sorry, guys, you're going to have to start trying or do something about this because you're not getting it and I can't keep carrying you," or something. I'm not sure exactly, but there seems like that provocative way of approaching it.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, if you're just in this for the miracles and the worldly power, then there's no point in your being here, you know, because that's not what I'm about.
Right.
Bill, at what point did this translate into people actually taking Eucharist? Was it quite some time?
Well, and that's the hard thing. I mean, this is, who knows when all these stories were told and how they were told. I mean, we're dealing with stuff that was written well after. People have been taking communion, most likely when this gospel was written, for at least 30 and maybe even 100 years, depending. So people were probably taking communion long before this was written, because that seemed to be something the disciples did almost immediately after Jesus' departure.
Okay.
And death. So, But who knows? I mean, this is that, what order were things told, written, and engaged is a tricky one to guess on, because this could have been something that happened exactly this way, and they were all really upset and didn't know, and they didn't figure it out until Jesus did sort of had that moment at the Last Supper or last instituted some meal ministry that they started to do it later. I don't know. It's tricky.
Bill, I wonder if the crowd, whoever they were, actually, if they did in fact understand what he was saying, would that further mean that they therefore understand the way of life that he is asking them to follow? Seems a disconnect. And I'm not sure if I were sitting in that crowd, I would really understand what he was trying to say. So I'm just curious about that.
I think I'd be with you, Roy. I'm not sure I'd get everything either. When someone's talking like in such a almost metaphysical way, it's like, well, no, I need something to, where's the terra firma, right? Like right. the father's with me, and who are we talking about? I need some more definite descriptions or some systematic theology or something that's a little bit, because it's not as straightforward. I mean, we get later on, we get that idea of like Jesus being the way and the truth and the life, and there's a different statement there. But this one, I'm not sure I don't know if I've been fed the day before. And then someone starts going like, now you have to eat my flesh. I'm not sure I'd jump in and buy either. I might be still on the literal level as well. I'd love to say I'd be deeper, but I don't know how many people would make that jump, because it's not one that is logical, right? Or at least not clear, unless you have an idea of who Jesus is before this. That this is the one, that the conversion moment for me at least.
And then what is he expecting the people to do? In other words, Are they expecting them to go out and just be kind to people, or do specifically, what is he wanting them to do to understand who he is? That's the hard part.
Yeah.
I mean, all of it.
The only thing that we really get in the Gospel of John is not that list of things that you're supposed to do. You're just supposed to abide with Jesus, right? Like, if Jesus is on the road, then you follow him on the road. And if he's teaching the temple, then you go to the temple and listen. And that seems to be the mark, at least so far in the description in John, of who this person is, right? The Samaritans learn from Jesus and abide with him for 2 or 3 days, and they believe, and that's the good, you know, they're listed as being good. The same is probably true here. I don't know that there's anything that we could point to and say, and then Jesus said, go and be good people. That's not in there. It's much more just like, well, believe who he is, believe that there's something bigger going on, and that's enough. It seems to be enough, or The start of something. But that's the frustrating part of John. He doesn't give us that list of things to do in the same way. It's much more this esoteric, not esoteric, but this deeply connected life with Jesus, where you just know almost through the Spirit and through God what to do, more than the list of things to do.
It's almost like if they understand that he is in fact the Messiah, then therefore they will automatically know what to do. I assume.
Yeah, it's almost, you just absorb it to a certain degree. Mm-hmm. We just have like about 8-9 verses left, so I'll just read those just so we can have them out there. But so Jesus asked the 12, do you also wish to go away? And Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. So sort of like you were saying, Roy, like this is, be faithful is just to say, I don't know, but you're the one who has the answer, so I'm going to stick with you. We've come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. Jesus answered them, Did I not choose you, the 12? Yet one of you is a devil. And he was speaking of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, for he, the one of the 12, was going to betray him. So that's pretty much the end of the chapter. And again, the thing that's fascinating here is, all of this sure sounds like the Last Supper. I just read all of this to you and didn't tell you where it was happening. I imagine we would all say the same thing, like, oh, this has to be the Last Supper, right? This has to be that moment, because you even have this moment where, oh, well, Judas is going to betray him. And all of this stuff that are the hallmark moments in Matthew, Mark, and Luke of the Last Supper are there, but instead it's told with in the context of the feeding of the 5,000. And so this fascinating thing that brings up a handful of questions that we can try to answer, but I didn't put it in there. Sorry. I mean, if it is connected to the feeding of the 5,000, does that mean that we have a different, there's a different understanding of the Eucharist, that it's not just for the faithful, but for anyone? Because Jesus doesn't really ask who believes in him for the feeding of the 5,000, right? It's not just an inside group, but it's this whole community. All these things start to get, if you really engage it in the context that John wrote it, has a different meaning. At the same time, he's super challenging to all those folks. And so maybe it is supposed to be a meal for those who truly believe to really devour God. And communion is hopefully going to be something that leads to a deeper relationship, not just a nice way to gather as a community. I don't know. These are all the questions that start to get begged when you really think about how this is written in the Gospel of John, because it is a very different place to have this conversation that is not in that upper room with just the 12 or just the immediate disciples that are the most trusted. This is everyone that gets sort of gathered together in a very different context and way. It's a much more public, even egalitarian meal. You have to wonder what John is trying to say with that. And I don't have an answer. I'm just saying, I'm asking the questions. Anything else from our Bread of Life discourse?
Are we going to work on this again next week?
We can. We can circle back around and talk about it some more. It's a lot. Part of it is, I mean, you got 75 verses, right? There's a lot of, there's a whole lot of text. So we can go back and recap this and play with it a little. Sure.
Well.
There's a lot. It's also why we get 6 weeks of it in the preaching cycle, because there's so much there to unpack, even if you can't necessarily preach it in quick and easy ways.
Is there anything, am I just making this up, but, you know, he's, like you said, it's an egalitarian meal. He's feeding the masses. He's telling us to believe he is the Son of God. Does he want us to turn then and feed the masses as well?
Well, there's certainly that moment, if we go back to the very beginning of the chapter, where they have that exchange. I think it's Andrew says, like, hey, we wouldn't have enough money in a million years to feed all these people. And but Jesus says, well, you give them something to eat, right? I mean, there's this sort of very clear thing of, like, well, you guys can do something. And, of course, they can't. All they can find is a small meal, a sort of lunch sack of a child almost kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
There is this idea that there is some level of responsibility for the disciples of feeding or of caring, of offering what little we have. That's definitely a theme of the feeding the 5,000 in all the versions. So maybe. That's a definite maybe. We should be feeding.
Bill, why do you think it is that the Catholics, that you're not supposed to take communion in the Catholic Church unless you are a Catholic?
Yeah, good question.
That's a good question. I mean, there are two reasons that are always given that I've been told expressly that I understand. One is that we don't have, that we're not in communion, that is, we don't have the same belief system as the Pope. And therefore, because our understanding of the Eucharist is different, that we should not participate is the one that I get told the most often, that because we don't have the same understanding of what's happening, then we should be separate for that reason. I think the other side of it is very much this idea that permeates a lot of people's understanding of the Eucharist, which is it was for the insiders. And if you're not part of the Catholic Church, then you don't need to be taking the Catholic Eucharist, right? The same is true for the Eastern Orthodox. If you aren't Eastern Orthodox, you don't take part in the Eastern Orthodox communion, right? This is not really until about 20, 30 years ago, the same was true for the Episcopal Church. No one but Episcopalians could take, and you had to be a confirmed Episcopalian. If you remember back in the day before the 79 prayer book changed, you literally had to be a confirmed Episcopalian before you could receive communion. And the idea was very much that because Jesus was feeding that inner circle of 12, in the inner group, that you would only want that inner group to gather and the people that you know to share communion with you, that you knew who they were. And so I think both of those ideas sort of get stacked on each other. We have gotten more egalitarian, like I said, in the last 20 years, because we have a better understanding of baptism, is where our change happened. And that is, wait, if you're baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, then we're all part of God's family. And so that's why we started having that conversation about open communion, was in response to the 79 prayer book, raising baptism and the priesthood of all believers to a higher level and a greater understanding that we're not in it alone. But yeah, it's, and it just depends on who you talk to. I mean, if you go to a Dominican church or a Jesuit community, they'll almost always give you communion, even if you're Methodist, Episcopalian, or anything in between.
Really?
Depends on which parts of the Catholic Church you're in.
You know, a couple things that occurred to me. One is that this dialogue with Peter is somewhat reminiscent of the encounter at Caesarea Philippi that we read about in the Synoptics, where he says, you know, "Who do they say I am?" And
right,
except that, you know, he says, you know, we have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. What's interesting is that his rationale is that you have the words of eternal life. You know, it's not that we've seen you do all these miracles.
Right.
And then he goes on to say, you know, to acknowledge that his betrayer is among them. So we get this notion that this is, he's moving ahead voluntarily knowing this. So one, you know, it's this, you know, which is certainly, you know, consistent with the Johannine approach that, you know, this Jesus is carrying out the plan, and the plan includes crucifixion and resurrection. But, you know, it's, I was thinking, well, perhaps here we are getting, it's also a message that the way of life that we're being taught here is about self-sacrifice. And that when Peter's saying, you have the words of eternal life, then the gospel writer has Jesus speak to this moving on the way toward the ultimate sacrifice. And that's part of what the words of eternal life are all about.
Mm-hmm. No, and I do think, yes, it's absolutely reminiscent of Peter's declaration in the Synoptics at Caesarea Philippi and all those moments where it's, who do you say that I am? Oh, you're the Messiah. But it is also that, with that Johannine twist, right? Like, we believe you have the words of life. Like, we don't believe you because we saw the miracles, but because the teachings are what matter and you are what matters, right? I mean, that Peter does get a pretty nice boost there as far as it seems to understand elementally what it is to be a disciple, even if he doesn't understand what the heck's going on. He seems to be part of that group saying, like, this is really hard. Am I supposed to eat you now? What happens with this? He doesn't seem to fully understand, but he has at least a deeper understanding that I need to keep trying and working at it, right? So he does get a little bit of a boost. And he also doesn't, if you notice, while Judas is terrible and awful, you don't have the betrayal of Peter, right? He doesn't deny him, or it's not listed at this particular moment in the same way, too. So there are these little tweaks that you have to wonder how John is telling the story, if he's trying to raise Peter up a little bit here, too, to say he doesn't always get it, but he definitely understands the elements of it. To be a Christian is to follow Jesus and know that he has the words of life, even if you don't understand them. You just keep trying to follow.
Do any of the other gospel writers talk about disciples abandoning ship because his teachings were so?
No, that's a unique to John too. I mean, this moment where they, a whole bunch of them go, this is really hard, I'm out. You don't see that apart from, I guess, maybe Judas, you could say, decides that he's out, but that's a different sort of context. You don't have that moment where a whole crowd leaves disgusted or frustrated with Jesus. You don't have that. He's not that challenging in the same way. Well, we're a little after one. We'll circle back around and see if we have any brilliant thoughts next week too about the Bread of Life discourse. Look ahead to chapter 7, where we have Jesus' teaching at the Festival of Booths, which is what we'll see then is this sort of passages and turns of Jesus showing up at lots of the Jewish festivals, and they're explicitly listed for what they are, and then Jesus has a response to each of those festivals, which is interesting. But yeah, we'll keep playing with all of this. It's good to see all of you. And Lynn, be safe. Hope you have a safe flight and everything goes well. And Kenya.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Bill.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you. Bill.
We'll see you all soon.
Let's all go eat some bread.
Bye-bye.
Bye.